afternoon, everybody, and welcome to our presentation of protonation dynamics in protein function. This is the name of our collaborative research center in German, Sonderforschungsbereich, SFB. And what you will hear now in the next 90 minutes is a presentation by the doctoral students of the Collaborative Research Center. The doctoral students are organized in an integrated graduate school, IGK. And I'm the spokesperson of the IGK, and I will guide you through today's presentation. What you will see in the next 90 minutes. Here's our outline. First, we will give you an introduction into proteins. This is a short talk given by Jacqueline Gottwald. Then, the next introductory talk is by Florian Brüning about protonation dynamics and theoretical methods. Then we will come to our five model proteins, which we investigate within the Collaborative Research Center. These are phytochromes, a talk given by Manal Ibrahim, Photosystem II, a talk given by Kalman Christe. Then we will go further on to cytochrome C-oxidase. The talk will be given by Victor Koos. And then, last but not least, we will present you two ion channel proteins, channelrhodopsin and viroporin. And these talks will be given by Louis Schubert and Swantje Moore. Now, let's dive deep into protonation dynamics in protein function. And we come to our first short presentation, Protein Introduction by Jacqueline Gottwald. Jacqueline, the stage is yours.
Hello, my name is Jacqueline Gottwald. I am from the Free University of Berlin, from the physics department. I am a member of the AG Alexeyev, and our topics are structural dynamics and function of biological systems, molecular biophysics, and nanomedicine. Today, I give you a small introduction to proteins. Proteins are large molecules, such as you can see here on the right side. Proteins are built up of many monomers. In case of proteins, these monomers are amino acids. Here on the left side, you can see a scheme of an amino acid. Amino acids consist of hydrogen, oxygen, carbon, and nitrogen atoms. And on the alpha C atom, here on this C, there's also a rest group or side chain bound. In humans, there exist 20 different side chains. So we have 20 proteinogenic amino acids. Here in this table, you can see the structure and names of these 20 amino acids. If you focus on the right-hand upper corner, you can see the structure of the aspartic acid. And you can also see that there exists a three-letter code and a one-letter code. In case of aspartic acid, the three-letter code is ASP and the one-letter code is D. Besides the side chains, there exist two other important groups in amino acids, which you can here see on the left side. These are the carboxyl group and the amino group. These groups can react with each other and form a peptide bond. Thereby, they build a peptide or peptide chain, which you can see on the right side. Here you can see an example of a peptide, which consists of five monomers. And if you imagine that this peptide consists of five different monomers, that means five different side chains. And if you take, for example, KLGSR, that corresponds to the amino acids, lysine, leucine, glycine, serine, and arginine. This is an amino acid sequence. The amino acid sequence is also called the primary structure of a protein. This structure can form a secondary structure. These are the alpha helix and beta sheet, which you can see here in the middle. These structures are stabilized by hydrogen bonds, also called hydrogen bridges. And from the secondary structure, we can go on further to the three-dimensional structure of the protein, which is the complete folded and fully functional protein structure, which you can see here on the right side. So now you have a basic knowledge of proteins and hopefully can follow the talks of my fellow PhD students. So thank you and enjoy the talks.
Thank you very much, Jacqueline. And now we come to our second talk, Protonation Dynamics by Florian Brüning. Florian Brüning, please come to the stage.
Okay. Thank you, Jacqueline. Where's the presenter? Thanks. Yeah, proton transfer dynamics. So we've gotten an introduction to the first part of the title, proteins. What about the second part, the protonation dynamics? Protonation dynamics basically means motions of protons. And taken together, the title can be paraphrased as proteins that involve motions of protons to be functioning. How can we now watch motion of protons? The proton is the smallest, is the nucleus of the hydrogen atom, and as such, the smallest atomic nucleus that we can that exists in nature and is therefore barely visible in experiments. Furthermore, it moves very, very fast. Look here at the time scale of the video that I'm showing you. It's on the order of picoseconds. That is 10 to the power of negative 12 seconds, or 1 trillionth of a second. This movie was generated by a computer simulation. This is a simulation on an atomic scale using the best model of the real world that we know today, which is quantum mechanics. Can't see my notes, sorry. And now we can basically, in this small virtual reality, run very tiny experiments to understand the motion of protons in proteins, and from that build theoretical models that we will then use to understand how proton signals will be visible in experimental data. How do these quantum mechanical computer simulations work? It's basically a laboratory in the computer. We start from a static structure of the protein that we take, for example, from experimental X-ray crystallography, which you will hear about in the following talk by Manal. Then we put in the elementary particles in this static structure, so the protons and the electrons. Here you see a visualization of the electronic orbitals in such a system, and then compute the atomic forces using the complicated equations of quantum mechanics. Then we can move using these forces, move the atoms a tiny little bit into the direction of the forces and obtain a new simulated structure. And if we repeat this process step by step, we obtain a motion picture of molecular dynamics. Now, these equations are very expensive, very complicated to solve, so it's impossible for humans to do that by hand. And we have to use computers, in fact, very, very large computers. The supercomputer that we use is called LISE, after the physicist Lise Meitner, and it's located here in Berlin-Dahlem at the Zuse Institute. It consists of around 1,000 nodes with a total of around 120,000 cores. So you can imagine 30,000 average computers hooked together that do the calculations together. And it is such, actually one of the largest computers in the world. So together with its sister system, EMMI, which is located in Göttingen, the supercomputer was ranked place 13 in the world back in 2019 when it was installed. So now coming back to the protons, how do protons move through proteins? Actually, proteins contain a lot of water, like most of life on Earth. And therefore, to understand the motion of protons in proteins, we actually have to understand the motion of protons through water. And for that, we simulated acidic solutions, because these contain really a lot of protons dissolved in water. Hydrochloric acid, which is seen here in the simulation, is a very strong acid, which means that the hydrochloric salt, when put into water, completely dissolves into protons and chloride ions. So the chloride ions you can easily make out in the simulation. They are the large balls between the water molecules. But the protons are difficult to see. I have to really highlight a small area where you see a proton that is here bound between two water molecules. And the reason why they are difficult to see is quite straightforward. Well, water also contains hydrogen atoms. It's the H2O, yeah, two hydrogen atoms per water molecule. And therefore, actually, the proton is the nucleus of the hydrogen atom, as I showed you on the, or explained on the first slide. And so you can see that the proton and the hydrogen, they can actually interchange the roles and move along this chain of water molecules in a very, very fast fashion by basically always switching the role. And this is called the Grotthus process. It was hypothesized already over 200 years ago, so it's quite an old concept. And it's a very fast chain reaction that really facilitates very fast proton transport, much faster than any other ion. What does that now mean for observing protons in experimental data? Well, the proton is electrically charged, and therefore you can imagine this moving charge much like an antenna, which absorbs electromagnetic radiation. And experimentalists use this by basically shining at a sample solution light, at which is electromagnetic radiation, at different frequencies, and see what part of the energy is absorbed, or at what frequencies the sample is absorbing, which means that there is an antenna that is existing in this solution that absorbs at this frequency. And then they obtain these absorption spectra. Here I show absorption spectra of water and hydrochloric acid solutions at different concentrations that we obtained, calculated from our quantum mechanical simulations, and that show very good agreement with experimental data. And in chemistry, this is used and is a very important measurement in general, and it's used much like a fingerprint, these absorption spectra, and with that, experimentalists can identify what they have in their solution. Now, there is also obviously other partially charged atoms moving in our system. For example, the water molecules, they are also polar and they move a lot. So this is the bending vibration of the water molecule, and this is the stretching vibration. And these normal modes are quite predictable. They happen at more or less a constant frequency. Here in these spectra, you can, on the right side, at 100 terahertz, see, for example, the peak of the stretching vibration of water. And then at 50 terahertz, there's another second peak, which is really the peak belonging to the bending vibration. And therefore, it's actually difficult to distinguish the proton signal from these other moving charges. So basically, the fingerprint of the proton is screened from other molecules in the system. Furthermore, what makes it more difficult, the proton is actually moving, as you can see in this time series, by these seemingly unpredictable jumps. It's moving in a very unpredictable fashion. It is actually a stochastic motion that is observed here for these protons. And yeah, this is basically where my group comes in, the group of Professor Netz at the Freie Universität Berlin. So we do a lot of theory on stochastic dynamics. So we work on mostly molecular level systems, so molecular vibrations, chemical reactions, but also some people work on much larger microscopic systems such as cell migration or weather prediction or animal searching patterns. And now we use these concepts of stochastic theory, so really analytic concepts, and apply them to this system of this traveling proton, and use concepts like here, for example, the waiting time, how long is the proton waiting on average on once before it's jumping, and then the transition path time, which is shown here in red, which is the time of the actual traveling path from one side, from one water molecule to the other, and apply that to now predict proton spectral signatures in here in hydrochloric acid solutions, where you can, for example, see by this red shaded area a prominent peak at 40 terahertz, which belongs to this proton transition path. And with these results, we hope that we can work together with experimentalists to understand and see proton signals in experimental data. Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much, Florian, for this fascinating insight into proton transfer experiments, or proton transfer in theory and in experiments. Now we come to our model proteins. As I already said, we have five model proteins. And the first one we will hear about is a phytochrome by Manal Ibrahim. And in addition to her talk, she also will show you a live experiment. Actually, she will show you how to crystallize a protein. Manal, the stage is yours.
Genau, as Ulrike said, I'm Manal Ibrahim, and I'm working at the Charité Mitte at the Institute of Medical Physics and Biophysics in the group X-ray crystallography and signal transduction in the lab of Patrick Scherer. Have you ever noticed that sunflowers turn their head with the sun, or that plants standing next to a window grow at an angle? We can see light with our eyes, and plants do that with a protein called phytochrome. Phytochrome use light as source of information and mediate various reactions, such as the germination of seed, the correct orientation of the phosphoratic apparatus, or the blooming of flowers, which you can see here. Interestingly, the photoreceptor also occurs in cyanobacteria, fungi, and even in heterotrophic bacteria who don't need light to exist or to produce energy. And there, the phytochromes, for example, control the transition from vegetative to generative growth phase in the fungi Aspergillus nidulas, or they're helping the formation of fruiting bodies in Myxobacteria. Besides their very important biological function, phytochromes can also be used for light-triggered medical application, which basically means to control the cell activity with light. Diseases such as Parkinson and Alzheimer have already been studied this way. And now you may maybe ask yourself how a single protein can take on so many different functions. And the first thing you should know to answer that question is that all phytochromes, regardless from which organism they're from, are having a common architecture, which is consisting of a light-sensing module and an output module. The light sensing module is quite variable, and since the output module is different from phytochrome to phytochrome, I will concentrate my further presentation on the light sensing part. This here is the protein structure of the light sensing module, consisting of PAS, GAF, and PHI. The second thing you should know to understand the function of phytochromes is that they can be turned on and off like molecular light switches. And this is caused by a small light-absorbing molecule called biliverdin. This is incorporated into the phytochrome. The phytochrome I'm showing you is in the far red state. And far red means that this phytochrome was activated with far red light to be in this state. Here you can see its characteristic absorbance spectrum with this small peak, and phytochromes in the PFR state are green. After illumination with far red light, the biliverdin ring rotates, and this caused a structural change in the binding pocket, which then leads to a major conformational change that you can see here. Consequently, we can say that the small shift of this biliverdin ring causes the change of the absorbance spectrum to this high peak here, and also it's shifted a bit to the left, and the phytochrome is now blue. The complementary color of blue is far red, which means that this phytochrome now in the PR state is absorbing far red light to reach the PFR state again. So, and one of the questions in my research group now is how the light signal that hits the biliverdin is passed on to the phytochrome protein and then leads to such a large structural change, and then, for example, causes sunflowers to turn their heads. And to understand this mechanism, we need the knowledge of the structure at atomic level. And in our CRC, we are trying to gain this knowledge in different ways. For example, there are groups doing computer simulations in which they can predict how atoms and molecules in proteins are moving. And here's an example of a so-called molecular dynamics simulation. Here you can see that the protein is quite flexible and very dynamic. And this is a prerequisite for major conformational changes, as you saw in the last slide. The calculation my colleague Duke did are based on a protein structure. And a protein structure can be solved in different ways. For example, by nuclear magnetic resonance, electron microscopy, or X-ray protein crystallography. And I will focus my further presentation on the X-ray protein crystallography because I'm working on that. The first thing you need to crystallize the protein is obviously to get the protein itself, and therefore we are programming our cells to produce overproduce mainly this protein, which then leads to a lot of protein, which is in the lab a couple of milligrams. And then we need to separate the protein of interest from the other cell components and the other proteins in the cells to obtain an purified protein for crystallization. In the next step, we are using our purified protein and add some salts and some other chemicals. And under some physical laws, the protein molecules assemble periodically to a crystal, and then we can receive, for example, this beautiful phytochrome crystal. And on this picture, you can see that protein crystals in general comes in very different shapes and colors. Here, for example, you can see one that kind of looks like a flower, or some diamonds in yellow, blue, every color, everything is possible, depending on the protein you're crystallizing. Then we take this protein out of the drop, I will show you that later, and bring it to a particle accelerator such as BESSY2 in Adlershof. Maybe you know it. And there X-rays are generated, and the X-rays are shot at the crystal, and then when they hit an electron, they are scattered, which creates an density pattern, as you can see here. Here, there are a lot of black points, and all those black points are the scattered electrons. And these scattered with help of these patterns, the computer can calculate the 3D map for us, the electron density, which lead us to the 3D model. And the obtained 3D model is the basis for mechanistic investigations, for example, the molecular dynamics simulation that I showed you in the beginning. To answer our initial questions, we did illumination experiments of different phytochrome variants to understand the signal transmission. And after assembling our knowledge, we gained an insight on how the movements of biliverdin in the binding pocket caused the signal to be transmitted to the protein, which you can see here. Genau. This video is made by my colleague Luisa Herder. Of course, there are still a lot of questions which we aspire to answer in the future, but for now I want to show you how we receive protein crystals in the lab. And therefore, the first thing we need is the protein itself, of course, and I haven't brought phytochrome with me because it's light sensitive, but instead of it, I got some lysozyme for you. It can be isolated from tears, for example, or can be found in egg whites. Then we need some chemicals, for example, sodium chloride, which is basically the salt we are using to cook, and a buffer. In this case, it's sodium acetate and in different pH, and some water to adjust the concentration. Okay. Genau, now, and genau, of course, we also need the 24 well plate, which is here. I bought it from my lab. And now I will start pipetting. Wie bitte? Ach so, ah, okay. But of course, I will do that. I will protect myself by wearing my lab coat and some gloves. I also brought some fine pipettes with me to pipette the small volumes. And now I'm going to start. It's a bit crowded because the table is not that big, but we will deal with that. Danke, Jackie. Okay, so the first thing we are going to pipette is the salt. So at first I'm taking a bit of the salt and put it into the first well, then into the second one, and the third, and the first one. Okay, and now I'm using the buffer, which is here. One, two, three, okay. And now the last solution is the water to adjust the concentration. I've also prepared another solution in the lab, which I will put in those wells, but therefore I have to increase the volume. Perfect. And now I will do the second row. Okay, great. So now to the fun part, the protein. Okay, we don't need that anymore. Okay, but the at first I need to shake it a bit so everything mixes well. And now I'm using the protein, which is stored in the ice, and the other pipette, the smaller one. And for crystallography, there are two methods. The first one is called sitting drop method, and therefore you are needing the small bridges here. I hope you can see it well. Achso, hier ist die Kamera, nein, hier. Genau, and here is a small hole, and you usually put the protein drop in this small hole. But I won't use this method now. Instead of this, I will use the so-called hanging drop method, and therefore I'm going to need this cover glass. Okay, I will put it here on the table, and then I will use 2 microliters, thank you, of the protein solution at first, and place the drop in the middle, and then 2 microliters of the reservoir solution. I'm usually doing this way to save one tip, because after pipetting many plates, you are using a lot of rubbish. Okay. So great. This one is the first drop. Now to the second one. Okay, I will do this on my hands now. Two microliters of the protein drop, and 2 of the reservoir solution. And then I'm going to repeat this step once again, but with this cover glass. You can also pipette more than one protein drop if you want to, and of course if you have enough protein. Okay, and now to the last drop. I won't make the others. And again the reservoir solution. Perfect. Okay, now we are almost finished, but I want to show you the drop before we are before the incubation time. So I will just use another one because I already closed the others. Okay, good. Now I will put the drop under the microscope. And now you probably see what I see. I see nothing. Okay, one moment. It's a photo. It's nothing. Ach so. Oh, I forgot to switch it on, I'm sorry. Okay, so this is the drop, and I need to focus a bit. Yes, here. But of course, you can't see anything because the protein drop is still clear. Okay, so, but the protein drop is clear, and in approximately 1 hour, I will come to the stage again and show you, hopefully, some crystals. Okay. So, with that being said, I want to hand again to Ulrike.
Yes, thank you very much for this very nice experimental insight in how we have to be focused, actually. You have seen how focused Manal was when she was pipetting and she was preparing the solutions for the crystallization. Okay, now, thank you very much again, Manal. Now we would like to switch back to our presentation. We need to switch, exactly, yeah, thank you very much, because now comes the second model protein of our CSC, and this is a photosystem too, and I would like to ask Kaiman Christa to the stage. Here, Kaiman. Thank you so much for coming.
Yeah. Hello, hello. Actually, where do I put this? Maybe I can do it manually.
We need some technical help. Okay. The technicians try to solve our problem, which is solved now. Okay, Kaiman.
Okay, excellent. I'm Kaiman Christa. I'm from the Freie Universität Berlin, Institute of Experimental Physics. And I belong to two groups, biophysics and photosynthesis, belong to AG Tau. And biophysics and biochemistry of photosynthetic organisms, which is part of the AG Nürnberg lab. So what is photosynthesis 2? It's a multi-subunit protein complex. You can see it here. Each subunit has its own distinct color. So as you can see, there are many subunits. What it does is essentially it gathers electrons from water splitting. And this is the first step of photosynthesis. Yeah, essentially it gathers the initial electrical input in photosynthesis. So it uses light energy to split water, and by this it generates electrons and protons, both of which are used in upstream reactions in photosynthesis. And it produces oxygen, so not only is it very important for the plant, it also has a relation to our own respiration. So, where can you find photosynthesis 2? First of all, as probably most of you know, it's found in plants or plant chloroplasts, which you can see here glowing red due to fluorescence. And also it can be found in cyanobacteria, which are seen here. Perhaps some of you know these bacteria from polluting ponds in the summer, so you can't swim in them. And in fact, chloroplasts of plants are descended from cyanobacteria. So it could be argued that all oxygenic photosynthesis is, in a way, performed by cyanobacteria. And look at how happy the plants are to have chloroplasts. So let's zoom in on the cyanobacteria. They contain special membranes called thylakoid membranes. These are more organized than plants, but effectively, they serve the same purpose, essentially as a scaffolding for photosynthetic reactions to take place in. And also, so these are the thylakoid membranes. The cell also has a cytoplasm, and within the thylakoid membranes, or they kind of form these pockets called thylakoid lumen. These are necessary in order for a proton gradient to build up between the cytoplasm and thylakoid lumen. So essentially, photosynthesis 2 generates protons, which build up in the lumen and can drive upstream reactions such as ATP synthesis in a similar way as a water wheel kind of is functioned by a pressure difference. And yeah, here's the PS2, which is our focus this talk. Let's zoom a little bit in on that. Photosynthesis 2 is actually a dimer, which means it has two essentially equal proteins. But we'll zoom in on one of the monomers here. So there are several cofactors within photosynthesis 2. Probably the most important one is the manganese complex, which is responsible for breaking water molecules apart to generate protons and oxygen. And the rest of these molecules essentially serve to ferry an electron to a plastoquinone pool from which it can power upstream reactions. How do we explore this protein? First of all, we need to acquire some biomaterial containing PS2. We either do this by buying some fresh spinach or something like that, or growing a lot of cyanobacteria. Then we need to extract proteins, purify them on a column, and validate our product to see if our extracted proteins are actually working. So when we know this, we can actually measure them. One of the methods of measurement which I personally use is called Joule polarography. This method involves the use of centrifugable electrodes. So these electrodes can sense oxygen in a solution. And what we do is we add some kind of photosynthesis 2, purified photosynthesis 2, to a buffer. We centrifuge it to spin it down to create a thin layer upon the electrode, which allows for non-diffusive limited measurements. And then we illuminate the sample. So what happens then? We get these oxygen transients. This example shows oxygen at different temperatures. As you can see, it's a bit faster at higher temperatures. And here you can see an actual Joule electrode with some oxygen production. So what do we investigate with these methods? One obvious factor are environmental effects on function. We measure at different pH and temperature, as you saw before. We also perform isotopic labeling, where we can add different isotopes of atoms that kind of integrate into the protein. And this way, we can locate the specific atoms within the protein, for example. Another method we use or investigate is site-directed mutagenesis. This method, we can replace component amino acids and measure the protein afterwards to gain insight on the specific role of individual amino acids. Likewise, we can actually replace entire subunits to gain information about them in a similar manner. And last but not least, we are interested in the structure of the protein. We can crystallize this protein and understand the structure through X-ray crystallography or cryo-electron microscopy, for example. What are potential applications of this research? One is to inform inorganic water oxidation catalysts, so we can figure out how to perform artificial photosynthesis through biomimicry, essentially by mimicking the work of nature in order to create something inorganic and perhaps easier to use. Another potential application is biological photosensitizers. These are essentially biological dyes that we can add to solar cells in order for them to function. And last but not least, we can inform some bioengineering of photosynthetic machinery. So could, for example, improve resistance to shading. Possibly we could expand the range of light usable for oxygen photosynthesis. And perhaps we can improve efficiency for production of biofuels, for example. Here you can see a subunit being replaced here. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Karlmann. And for this insight into photosystem 2. And now we come to another protein which uses both protons and electrons. And this is a cytochrome C oxidase. And Victor Lohokus will give you this presentation. Please, Victor.
Thank you. Hello. So I am Victor Loyo. Actually, I'm working in the Freie Universität. She's my professor, and I am doing structural dynamics and function of biological systems. Let's start. As you remember from the last talk, the plants are able to produce specific energy by the absorption of sunlight in combination with CO2 and water molecules. This water, then the plants can release oxygen. This oxygen is taken out by the humans in combination with food molecule foods. And along these different metabolic pathways, we can produce one of the most known energy molecules, ATP. This ATP we can find or is produced in large quantities in the electron transport chain. And there we have or we find the cytochrome C oxidase. So keep in mind. But where is exactly this electron transport chain? Actually, we have in our cells, to be more precise, in the mitochondria. This mitochondria is also known as the powerhouse of the cell. And one thing that for me was so awesome is that this mitochondria has its own mitochondrial DNA, but more interesting is only inherited from women. So I like that. But coming back to this electron transport chain, as you can see here, the first four proteins are responsible to produce a specific proton gradient. This proton gradient is taken out by the ATP synthase that is responsible to produce energy. This energy, as I said before, is ATP. And this energy we can use for our daily life to walk, talk, and breathe. So, but now we are focusing to study the cytochrome C oxidase. It's the last protein in the electron transport chain. Why? Because for its limiting rate characteristics. So in order to study this protein, we are using this crystal structure. This crystal structure has two subunits, subunit 1 and subunit 2. They are doing the minimal functions in the protein. But for instance, in humans, we have 12 subunits, but it's not possible to work directly with that. That's why we are using this protein. In general, as you can see on the title, we say that cytochrome C works as a battery. Why? Because the protein is able to produce by pumping protons against a specific proton gradient, it's possible to produce a specific protein motive force. This protein motive force charges the membrane of the protein, and therefore we can say that the protein is working as a battery. But how is regulated this mechanism? Because it's quite complex. As you can see on the right side, we have this catalytic cycle. This catalytic cycle describes every step of the protein. However, and I'm not going to talk too much, but in general, the protein takes four electrons from another protein. Those electrons go directly to the protein. And then in the middle of the protein, several reactions happening. One of them is when those electrons are in that side, in the entry side, they can either reduce the oxygen molecules and release water molecules, or at the same time go to the other side of the protein and produce a specific proton gradient that we also call a membrane potential. That's why we already know when the protein is not working perfectly or has specific malfunctions, we can relate to specific diseases, for example, oxidative stress, inflammation, neurodegeneration, that is related to Alzheimer, and diabetes, obesity. That's why we are still interested to LOC diet to understand completely the mechanisms of the saccharomyces oxidase, because so far it's not so clear. And how we do that? Well, there exist different techniques. One of them is using X-ray crystallography, and with that we can use molecular dynamic simulations. But currently, in our group, we are using two main techniques, absorption spectroscopy and fluorescence spectroscopy. With absorption spectroscopy, as you can see, it's a representation how we measure the proteins. We are using a specific source light. This light is split in different wavelengths. And then the protein, depending on the state of the protein, either oxidized or reduced state, is going to show a specific spectrum that is unique for each state, that you can relate with a specific, you can relate, or you can say that it's a fingerprint. Also, this absorption is the logarithm of the intensity of the sample, the ratio of the sample and the reference light, and we can get the fingerprint. And one thing that is so awesome, well, at least for me, we can track this transition between the oxidized and reduced state by a specific technique that is a transient absorption spectroscopy. As you can see in this representation, basically, we can see this changing between oxidized and reduced state by the injection of the first electron. This electron is going to the protein, then to the copper A, and finally to the heme A. This is in the scale of microseconds. And finally, by fluorescence spectroscopy, we are using specific dye molecules that, when those dye molecules are excited, the photons, the fluorescence photons, are emitted on a specific, these photons are emitted in the transition from the lowest excited state back to the ground state. It's expressed in this scheme, Jablonski diagram, and therefore with these molecules that are able to fluoresce, we can combine with a specific functional protein that is saccharomyces oxidized and electron donor saccharomyces, we can detect this fluorescence signal. And as I said before, this fluorescence signal is expressed as a membrane potential. That means that a specific reaction is happening inside of the protein, is able to reduce the oxygen molecules, release water, and finally to release the protons and produce this membrane potential. Finally, we did the same experiments with a non-functional protein, and we didn't detect any fluorescence, and that means that we didn't produce, or the protein didn't produce any membrane potential. That's why we can relate this specific diseases with a specific mutations in the saccharomyces oxidase, and can be affect the electron transport chain. As a consequence, we can get the specific diseases. Thank you so much, and yeah.
Yeah, thank you so much, Victor. Yeah, so now you have seen how important the investigation of this molecule is also for understand diseases, yeah, disease pattern. Now we come to ion channels. And here you will see even more how important is the basics, the fundamental understanding of these proteins, yeah, in order to understand disease states. The next talk is about channel rhodopsin and will be given by Louis Schubert. Yeah, please, the stage is yours.
Hi, and welcome also from my side to the deep dive about channel rhodopsins. My name is Louis, and I'm working in the same institute as Victor, but in the group for experimental molecular biophysics by Joachim Heberle. Before I introduce you to the world of channel rhodopsins, I would like to draw your attention to a somewhat different but related protein we are using in our everyday lives. So right as you are following this talk and you are looking at these slides, you are using a protein named rhodopsin. It is located in the retina of our eyes and is the central part of our vision. It is a photoreceptor protein, and it consists of an apoprotein named the opsin, and it binds a dye molecule, the so-called retinal chromophore. This retinal chromophore is what gives this protein its reddish color and makes it interact with light. So when light hits this protein, it's being absorbed by the retinal chromophore. And this leads to a rather simple but very fast photoreaction. It is a light-triggered photoisomerization from the 11 cis to the all-trans retinal, which is basically just a rotation around this double bond as indicated with this blue arrow. This reaction takes place within 200 femtoseconds, which is less than a trillionth of a second. So how does this very fast photoreaction now lead to the signal which can travel to our brain? So this is depicted in the scheme over here. As I said, the light is being absorbed by the rhodopsin, and the rhodopsin then afterwards undergoes a structural change. And this triggers a very complex signaling cascade, which involves many different proteins. These proteins all interact with each other. And ultimately, this leads to the closure or the opening of ion channels, which are located in the membrane of our nerve cells. So in a nutshell, light absorption leads to a change of how charges can move across a membrane. Or in other words, a light signal is transformed into an electrical signal, which can travel to our brain. Now, what distinguishes now a channel rhodopsin from the rhodopsin we are using? Structurally, these proteins are very similar, and both of them harbor this retinal chromophore, which absorbs the light. However, their mode of function is very different. The channel rhodopsin works basically like a sluice gate. Upon absorption of light, it opens up and lets ions flow across the membrane following the concentration gradient. These proteins were found in green algae, as shown here, and they make them sense the light and transfer the signal to the flagellum so they can move and the algae can move away or to the incident light. So altogether, this protein is a simpler version of the rhodopsin we are using because it's at the same time a photoreceptor and an ion channel, and it does not need to interact with different other proteins. Quite similar proteins are not light-activated channels, but light-activated pumps. So they can actively pump ions across the membrane even against their concentration gradient. This happens actively by the absorption of light, as such a water pump would pump water from a reservoir up. These kinds of proteins are found in the membrane of different bacteria, and they are known to be involved in the energy production for these cells. So upon light absorption, they transport, for example, protons across the membrane and convert by this light energy into an electrochemical energy. This electrochemical energy can then be used by a different protein, the ATPase, to produce ATP. This is the energy currency of our cells. So how do we in our SFB investigate channel rhodopsins? Fortunately, we can make use of the fact that the protein, more precisely this retinal chromophore, interacts with visible light. We can measure exactly this interaction with UVV spectroscopy, and what we get is such a UVV spectrum you see over here. Now what we then want to do is we want to investigate the protein while it's working, so while it's conducting ions. So we start the reaction of the protein, which is indicated by this photocycle here, and then we can measure a series of these UVV absorbance spectra over a broad time range from a few nanoseconds up to several seconds. By this we can watch the protein conducting ions. Now if there will any structural changes happening close to the retinal chromophore or in its or directly at the chromophore, we will see this because then the UVV absorption will change as indicated here. And over time you see that the UVV absorption indeed changes. So with this experiment we have a first indication that directly at the chromophore or its direct vicinity, protonation events take place. But how can we now relate the structural dynamic information to the function of the protein? What we can do is the following experiment, as shown here in this red trace on the side, where we measure the current which is exhibited by this ion channel as a function of time. And in the case of this protein, we were able to show that this protein conducts ions at around 1 millisecond, and this relates to these spectral intermediates I mentioned before. So now we have a first hint that protonation events take place close to the retinal chromophore, but we don't really know what's going on inside the protein. As Florian mentioned already earlier, protons are very hard to detect. And with optical spectroscopy, we cannot really measure protons directly. But what we can do is we can trace them indirectly. And for this, we use another spectroscopic method, which is called infrared spectroscopy. With infrared spectroscopy, we measure molecular vibrations, as illustrated here in this animation. Here I show you molecular vibrations of an amino acid with a carboxylic side chain, which is shown here in this chemical formula. Now, these carboxylic side chains, they are very prone to lose or to gain a proton. So indeed, at these amino acids, protonation events take place within proteins. Now, if we measure with an infrared spectrometer these vibrations very precisely, we can really distinguish between the protonated and the deprotonated form if we look very careful at these infrared spectra. So by this, we can see at which amino acid in the protein a proton transiently binds. So we have only one dilemma in such proteins. There are many amino acids which can transiently bind a proton. So how do we find then the amino acid where the proton really is? For this, we need to do the following. We repeat the very same experiment, but this time we use a variant of this protein where we exchanged only one amino acid, for example, this aspartic acid 156. If we exchange this and then we see a change in this infrared spectrum, we can really assign this protonation event to this one specific amino acid in the protein. So in the case of this channel rhodopsin 2, we were able to show that aspartic acid 156 gives away its proton at around 2 milliseconds to this retinal chromophore and gets another proton back at a later stage. So what we ultimately get in the end is such a molecular movie, or a series of snapshots, if you want. We learn a lot about the mechanistic details here, and we can really trace the movement of protons within these huge proteins. Over the past years, we have learned that protonation events are of fundamental importance for the function of these kinds of proteins. However, we gained this knowledge only by a collaborative effort. For such a molecular movie like this, we need the information from crystallography experiments like Manal shows you. We need calculations by Florian, and we need results from many, many spectroscopic experiments by, for example, Victor or me. Before I come to an end, I would like to give you a little introduction to a possible application of these kinds of proteins. So in the field of optogenetics, researchers combine the methods from optics and genetics. This method enables the non-invasive control of neurons. So let me explain you briefly how this works. It starts off with the genetics part. So first of all, you take the algae, and you need to isolate the gene which encodes for such a channel rhodopsin. If you succeeded with this, you can take the gene and bring it into a host cell, for example, such a neuronal cell. The cell then will by itself express this protein. So before, it's non-light activatable, but now it has a lot of this channel rhodopsin in its cell membrane, and now it's light activatable. So now you can trigger this neuron only by shining light on this. This method nowadays works in vitro and as well in vivo, and the great benefit of this is that we can now non-invasively control neuronal cells only by shining light on this. Before, researchers had to insert little cables into the cells to trigger them. And with this, I'm already at the end of my talk and want to thank you for your attention and hand over to the next speaker.
Yes, thank you very much, Luis. And now, as you can see, we are already at the end of our short talks. This is the final short talk, Viroporin, which will be given by Svantje Moore. Please, Svantje. Yes, it's yours.
Hello. Yeah, so you can hear me, right? Okay, so I'm going to talk about viroporins. I'm Svantje Moore. I'm at the structural biology group from Adam Lange, and I'm not in the FU, but at the Leibniz Institute for Molecular Pharmacology. I'm a PhD student there. So I think, like this? Okay. So I think, especially in the last 2 years, but maybe also before, you all heard a lot about viruses. There are different kinds of viruses, and they can cause different kinds of diseases. They all look very differently, but they have one thing in common, or most of them have that, and that are viroporins. Viroporins are membrane proteins, so they are inserted into the virus membrane, and they transport protons, but also small ions, through this virus membrane into the virus. Every kind of virus has its kind of its own kind of viroporin. As you can see here, there are four examples, and they look very differently, but they have some structural features which you can find in every viroporin. And the most important one is this transmembrane domain, so the part in the red part of the slide, and it's mostly an alpha helical secondary structure. Why do the viruses need these viroporins? I'm going to explain that with the example of M2, which you can see on the third position. It's a viroporin from influenza virus. And this influenza virus infects the host cell by inserting itself into the host cell and then being into an endosome. So it's at the second step, you can see that the virus is inserted into a second membrane, and this membrane has to fuse with the virus membrane to then release the virus RNA into the cell and produce new viruses. The M2 viroporin is important, first of all, in this step, because here it regulates the pH value in the virus and thus enables the two membranes to fuse and then release the RNA. The second step where the viroporin gets very important is the packaging and budding. Budding means that new virus particles are formed out of the host cell membrane. And here this M2 induces this membrane curvature so that the new virus particle can be released into the outside. How do viroporins exactly work? So I already said they transport ions through the membrane, but they have some other features which are important. So first of all, there's this N-terminus at the outside of the virus membrane. Then there's the cytosolic domain, and the most important part is the conductance domain, so the part in the membrane. This conductance domain, in the example of M2, consists of four identical subunits, and each subunit has two amino acids which are important for the proton conductance. As you can see here, every subunit has these two amino acids. And these amino acids are 1-histidine and 1-tryptophan. And as you can see in this scheme, first of all, the proton, which then gets conducted, binds to one of the amino acids, in this case, the histidine. Then the histidine is protonated and it brings the proton through the channel. And in the last step, the histidine converts its own protonation to the tryptophan so that this whole process can start again. On the right side, there's a model of a viroporin. Unluckily, we don't have a structure of this M2 yet we can show, but it's another proton channel, it's another ion channel, and as you can see, the ion, which is the orange dot, gets to the channel in several steps, as I already explained, so it's the same with protons and even ions. Why do we investigate these iroporins, or why are they so interesting? I think there are four most important points. First one is that viroporins are very easy to produce, so we can use our knowledge on how to investigate them for other membrane proteins. Then if we get structures for viroporins, we can feed them into databases, and these databases can be used for further protein structure prediction. Also, as I said, the viroporins can influence pH values, so they can be used for functional assays or biotechnological applications. And maybe the most important thing right now is, of course, they can be used for drug and vaccine development against the virus where the viroporin is in. For all these applications, we need biological, chemical, but also structural and dynamic informations. And to gain these structural and dynamics information, we already heard there are several methods, for example, crystallography, but in our lab we use NMR spectroscopy. NMR stands for nuclear magnetic resonance, and it's a spectroscopy method where we put our sample into a big magnet, as you can see on the right-hand side. So there's a picture of the NMR spectrometer. It's really high, but most of it is just, as you can see in the middle, helium, and so liquid helium and liquid nitrogen, which is used for cooling the conductance coil in the middle, and this conductance coil produces a magnetic field. Our sample, on the other hand, is really small. So as you can see here, we put our protein in little rotors, which are not larger than one coin. We measure then spectra. So with NMR spectroscopy, we can detect nucleic information, so atomic information about three nucleuses, carbon, protons, and nitrogen. In this case, we detected a carbon spectrum. And as you can see, there are two signals, because in this molecule, there are two carbons. So this is really easy for small molecules. But if we look at proteins, of course, they are much bigger, and they have a lot more carbons if we only detect them. So in this case, every green ink is one carbon. So if we then measure again a spectra, it looks like this. So there are a lot more signals, and also they overlap. So we cannot really assign one signal directly to one carbon. To overcome this problem, we measure two-dimensional spectra, where we can see correlations between directly bonded carbon atoms. So each point in the spectrum refers to one carbon correlation. And then if we look deeper into it, so that's the same spectrum, but just a part of it, we can see that there are specific amino acids from the protein occurring in specific regions. So the left one are probably correlations between serine and tyrosine, and the upper one between valine and proline. So with these spectra, we get mostly distance information, but also coupling informations. And we can then use them to improve molecular dynamic simulations. So if we already have the structure and then feed them our data from the NMR, we can get more information also about the flexibility of some parts of the protein or the membrane environment. So that was my talk, and with that I'm going to hand over.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much, Svante. And indeed, we are almost at the end of our presentation. But remember, Manal was showing us, after her phytochrome talk, a live experiment, the crystallization of lysosome. And now we would like to see whether the protein is already crystallized. Please, Manal, do you need that?
No, thank you. Okay, so let's switch to the camera, please. Yes, perfect. Now I'm going to look at the first wire, this one here. I'm going to put the cover glass with a drop on the microscope, and then hopefully we can see the drop. Yes. Wow, okay. Yeah. Let me focus it. Better now? Okay, so here we can see two tiny little crystals. Here and here, and also some other things, but maybe we have more luck in the other well. Here's also a lot of.
Wow!
Wow, yeah, it's a lot. I think it's too much light. Okay, but we can already see a lot of crystals. And, oops. Can I see the drop, please, again?
Yeah,
ah, perfect. Okay, so, great. Okay, I can't switch a bit. Okay, so I focused it a bit, and maybe you can see that we have two different crystals. One is more elongated, and it has 8 edges, and the other one is more cubic. But I've prepared other crystals in the lab 3 days before, and I think they are more sharp because they are older. For example, this well here. Okay, these crystals actually look a bit strange. They are kind of broken in the middle. So I won't use them for this structure. But maybe those small ones, they look very good. Here and here. But the interesting thing for lysozyme is that it's that there's also another crystal form, which is I hope. Maybe this one. Yes. Mach's mal ein bisschen dunkler, bitte. Ja. Ja, das ist perfekt. Okay, so now you are seeing something completely different. It looks like maybe a star or a hedgehog. And you see a lot of tiny needles here, and those needles are very hard to fish because when you want to observe the structure, you need one single needle. They're very hard to separate, which means that you have to be very precise, like a Shirok, while fishing them out. And that's why those crystals are not the best for the crystallization. But you can see that under this one, here's another crystal. Maybe you can fish this if you wish. Yes, okay. So, I have also some wells where the crystals are a bit smaller. For example, here, you can see they're very tiny. Do you see it? Yes, well, this picture is very beautiful. I love it. Okay, great. So here, a lot of small crystals. For example, this one is very small. This one is cubic. Then this one is more elongated with 8 edges. You can see the that they're very sharp, but you can also see that there are a lot of crystals assembling to each other, which is not good for finding the structure. Yes. Yeah. Okay. And I think here we have two different crystals. Yes. And here you can see that in the same condition, the protein assemble in a different manner, which was also very interesting for me to see. Okay, if you want to see more crystals, you can also talk with me after the presentation if you wish. Okay. Well, thanks a lot.
Yes, thank you. Nice. So, yeah, that were really, really beautiful crystals. And you have not seen only the beautiful crystals, but also an excited scientist, because she was really, as you have seen, yeah, excited about the beautiful crystals, yeah, which she has seen under the microscope. And with that, we are at the end, really at the end, of our event today. And I would like to thank first all of our collaborators within our Collaborative Research Center. Yeah? So as Luis was pointing out, it's not a single experiment, it's a collaborative effort, yeah, of all the researchers together in our Collaborative Research Center. But mostly, I would like to thank the doctoral student members of the IGK, first of all, those seven who made this event happen today. Thank you very much. And of course, I also would like to thank you for your attention. And with that, I would like to say goodbye and stay healthy. Bye-bye.